Okay, guys, we are back with our interactive session with peers in the industry. We have Edward Benning, we have Maarten van Bree, and we have Marije Linden. First of all, I would like to ask Edward to give a short introduction about himself. Edward.
Yes, thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Edward Benning, 20 years plus experience in Accenture, with a brief step into the industry, returning back into Accenture only 3 years ago. Based in Amsterdam, leading the digital manufacturing group here in Accenture Netherlands.
Right away from your home, that's good to see. We have also Maarten. Hi, Maarten, how are you doing?
Hi, thanks. I'm fine. Thank you and welcome everybody. My name is Maarten van Bree. I'm a managing director in our supply chain operations practice in Accenture in the Netherlands. And I focus on engineering, manufacturing and after sales service.
Okay, thank you. And then we have last but not least, Marije with the same green background as we have in our studio. Hi, Marije.
Hey, Tom. Yes, my name is Marije Linde. I'm working as well, of course, at Accenture, 12 years of experience in people and transformation, leading the talent and organization, how we call that, in the Eindhoven region, the high tech, where I'm experienced in, and also living in the Eindhoven region.
Okay. When you have questions for my guest in this panel discussion, please put them in our chat. We will also ask you there some questions about the statements that we are going to talk about. And I would like to start with the statement of Maarten. And the statement is, what are the main challenges in the manufacturing landscape today?
Yeah, so when we talk about challenges in manufacturing, of course, the corona pandemic puts an extra challenge on everybody, but also in manufacturing. But if I look at the markets, there are a couple of trends that impact the manufacturing industries in across the world. So the first one is basically in every industry, you see that products are more rapidly introduced. Customers also desire more products, which means also that there is a shorter time to earn money on products, but also it put a pose on the flexibility that you need to quickly ramp up, but also ramp down introduction and ramp down of products. Second one is that we as customers, we also like customization, and we like to have much more options to choose from for every product, whether it's a consumable like food or drinks, up to more premium products like cars and jewelry, for example. So this is another trend. Next is that if you look at business models, the traditional model from just selling a product is also gone. We tend to sell products, but also services in the entire life cycle of our products. Now, the fourth one is that where we used to sell kind of products as standalone products, you see now that hardware and software are integrated in our products, so which has another challenge in the product itself. And the last one, but definitely one of the most important, is that the linear supply chain has come to an end. Every manufacturer needs to take care of the products they sell to the markets, that in one way or the other, it comes back and it needs to be recycled or reused in one way or the other. Now, what brings us all together is that as a manufacturer, you need to be very flexible to adapt to all these trends. And I think the corona pandemic has shown that those companies that are good in that are able to quickly ramp down, but also in a few months when we're hopefully over this pandemic, to quickly ramp up again, those are the companies that benefit from this kind of pandemics. And we'll discuss that later in this webcast. Digitization, of course, is one of the big levers to become flexible.
Okay, that's very clear. Thank you, Maarten. And that's, of course, the business value part, but we have also the technology part. Edward, what can you say about that part?
Yeah, so if you look at all these trends, digital manufacturing is a way to bridge the gap to realize these trends in the business, to support us on the digitization, there's a number of emerging technologies that have become available over the past period and have been accepted. That can help us. Technologies like cloud, big data, data integration, analytics, artificial intelligence, machine learning, a digital twin, digital thread, IoT edge computing, you name them, virtual reality, augmented reality. There's many, many different technologies becoming available. And of course, how can we leverage these technologies to meet the digital manufacturing objectives, to meet the overall objectives? And before we can answer, we first need to understand these technologies. And we will soon see that they require complete new capabilities across the whole organization, at different departments, at different levels in the organization, from shop floor to boardroom. But the next question is where to start and on this digital manufacturing journey. And one started is how to scale. And earlier this week, I heard a nice example explaining a little bit this journey. Someone told me it's like climbing the Mount Everest. You don't do this out of the blue. You don't today start to climb the Mount Everest, and that's something that is you're thinking about for years, and it requires a lot of preparation. And once you get to the mountain, you go from camp to camp, from base camp to camp one to camp two, and sometimes you need to go back to a camp to acclimatize. But at the end of the day, with the right preparation, with the right support, under the right circumstances, and with the full dedication, you might get where you want to be. And it's even more complicated because we are manufacturing already for many years and quite successful, and we need to continue manufacturing. So we need to keep the shop open while making this change and this journey. So it's like climbing the Mount Everest, but having a full-time job on the side. So what it tells us a little bit is technology is not the biggest challenge, and this is the people, and the people change.
Exactly, and that's also important for your part, Marije, because the workforce part. Edward mentioned that already. It's also very impactful on the whole system.
Yes. Yeah, so if you look at business challenges Maarten explained and the technology disruptions we now see, people also have to move with this. And we see five challenges looking at the digital manufacturing from a people perspective. Like first of all, the widening talent gap, and that has directly to do with the human and AI factor, so balance that change. What task will be done by people versus what will be done by technology, and map those current jobs and skills. The second challenge is your strategy actually about the adaptive workforce, so your flexible workforce. So have you thought as an organization, for example, how you can fill those skill gaps and how will you address the demand in jobs versus the capacity you have? So will you more hire people? Will you up or reskill? Also what is mentioned by Peter and Tracy. Will you make use of that third party, so the adaptive workforce, or push robotics a little bit more, or make a mix? And within Accenture, we call that as well the buy, borrow, build, bot principle. And that's important to create your strategy. The third one is then obviously upskilling, because retaining your core talent is super important for your growth of your organization, but it can fail if you do not have that clear plan in place. So again, it's about a plan. Linking to technology, for example, there are programs with skill-based AI technology to really validate where your reskilling needs are in your organization. And that can accelerate then to make your decisions on your strategy going forward. The fourth challenge is actually that it is the hardest jobs to fill directly have the biggest impact on your company performance. So the skilled workers are more and more harder to find. So how do you bridge that gap? So you can do re-upskilling, but it can also be what I also see at clients in the Netherlands, that you need the senior people need to train the juniors, and you have to create a program, for example, a coaching program around this. And the fifth challenge we see is actually the combination of this all. So if you transition from your current workforce to this new skilling, will people maybe lose their job or not? Or can we still reskill them? So a little bit of fear or also the culture aspect can also pop up. So all in all, the assessment and your strategy of your workforce is super important.
Okay, let's move on back to Maarten, because what changes, Maarten, do you think will drive transformation and digitalization?
There's changes in the markets, basically, that basically put a challenge on all the industries to digitize their entire supply chains and also the manufacturing systems to be able to deal with that flexibility needed to be able to remain competitive and deliver products against cost and safety and everything that you need. On the other hand, indeed, so if you look at the internal side from an organization, there's a lot of change needs to happen on the technology side, but there's also, as Marije explained, we need to change also our workforce. And this is actually one of the most important aspects in basically digitization. We typically start talking about digitization, about technology, but it is clear that it is the people and the human aspect that is actually the most difficult and the most important to think about in a digital transformation. So digital transformation, in the end, it's much more of a human transformation than it's about technology.
Why is that? Why is it so hard?
It is hard because in the end, it's a lot about emotions as well. So there is fear of, will I lose my job? Will my job be replaced by robots? Will I lose my job because of AI algorithms taking over my role? But in the end, it is not about losing jobs here. I mean, digitization is an opportunity. However, we need to upskill our people. So the work that we do today is not the work that we do tomorrow. And so we need to guide our people, our workforce, around learning new skills, learning new capabilities, working together maybe with robots, working together with algorithms. And then in the end, we see that there is actually job creation rather than jobs lost. But we need to explain that story to the workforce. We need to guide them in how to transition from where we are today to where we want to be tomorrow.
Yeah,
that's
so
important.
So Edward, the things Maarten mentioned, it can be maybe by using technology less hard to implement things. Can you give an example of a successful implementation?
So if I can continue a little bit on what Maarten was just telling, is if you look at the majority of the workers, what we want to make a step change in improvement in output, making this ever evolving or higher targets we need to make. And if you look at shop floor, if you ask the people at shop floor, I'm really convinced that 99% will embrace this new technology if that makes their life easier. And sometimes, often, we are looking for to make it the life easier, and we're looking for this real improvement. Understand that if at shop floor, if they're running a day with a lot of breakdowns or changeovers, that's a crazy day. And if it's all automated and going smooth, that is also what they're looking for at shop floor. But to embrace this new technology and to start applying that and moving from, let's say, the experienced way of working to a data-driven way of working, and that requires a change in mindset. And this is not something to be done over time. And again, it's we need to do this while continuously meeting these challenging targets we have.
Exactly. And Marije, you all mentioned that it is important to train a younger generation. How can you do that in a right way?
If you focus on that one particularly, for example, you can set up for a coaching mechanism that you put the seniors more in a knowledgeable position, and then directly the juniors can grow. So it works then on both sides. But what you see often also in the manufacturing landscape is that it can lack of coaching or leadership skills, because people or the seniors were not used at all to use those skills, but really use their detailed specialist skills. So in order to make this work, you also have to focus on that part to help them in order not to fail your program.
Okay, let's move on because we can talk a lot about this subject because it's so broad and there are more things to talk about. But due to the time, we have to move on to the second question. That's the question for Edward, because it's also important, Edward, to talk about data because there are a lot of data. What opportunities for growth are there for digital manufacturers to maximize the use of data?
Yeah, it's all about data. And in the previous talk, Peter mentioned that we're moving from an analog world, an experience world, to a digital world, which is data-driven world. And in digital manufacturing, I would say it's all about having the right data at the right place at the right time. And that sounds quite easy, but... What we see is we are, at some point we are still fairly blind. We acquire a lot of data already, but if you look at shop floor, at the assets, the equipment, the tools, and the people running at shop floor, we are often quite blind. And to make the right decisions, we need also to have these insights. And once this data is available, we need to integrate it. Integrate to close the loop across the product lifecycle, from R&D to manufacturing to support for continuous improvement. Integrate across the supply chain or the value chain, both incoming and outgoing, even towards the partner, so across the boundaries of the company sometimes, to create better visibility and the agility. And integrate within the company from shop floor to boardroom, as Tracy mentioned in the previous talk, to create this visibility and transparency. And on top of this, we can include intelligence, technologies like artificial intelligence, machine learning, to make that an integrated part of the process and control. We can make this real step change in optimization.
But Edward, I can imagine that people and also companies need the right connection, for example, with their systems, right?
Yeah, so we see a connectivity at all levels, from the machine level, PLCs and SCADA level to the systems and between systems. So, and that is a challenge. How do you all bring it together and leverage the integration and the big data part?
Yeah, okay. I would like to ask that question, Maarten. You can maybe give an answer. How well connected is, for example, the Netherlands?
Well, I'm sure that we do great things in the Netherlands around connecting our assets, connecting, digitizing our society, our companies. From that aspect, we are doing well. However, also referring to the research that we did as Accenture that Tracy referred to as well. So we asked many different companies across many different industries across basically the whole world. So where are you basically on the maturity curve in your digitization of your operations, including manufacturing? And then, of course, you see a scattered landscape where oil and gas was on the top. But if you look at what is the average around the developed countries, around all the industries, you see that the majority of the companies is still in the phase where we say, well, we have done a successful proof of concepts, but we fail or we cannot yet scale it to enterprise level. So it also means that if you really want to get the value out of it, you need to be able to scale from basically doing the tests of the technology in isolated maybe factory production line. You have to be able to then to move it up in the rank. Now that's basically the state of the industry, and the Netherlands is not different than basically the rest of the world in that. Now, the good thing is that there are companies, there are organizations which have been able to do that already. So, and I'm not going to give you basically the silver bullet, because there is no silver bullet. If you do this, this, and this, you will be successful. But there are a number of things that I can tell you that I also implement myself at some of my clients, where we clearly see really good ROIs of doing it. And this basically centered around three elements. So one is, of course, you need to have data, but you don't have to have perfect data. I said that's a misbelief that is there. You can already start with the systems you have today, Of course, there needs to be a roadmap of how are you going to mature further on that. But let's start what you have today. That's what you have. That's what you already can monetize. So how to turn data using analytics into insights that are related to your business priority. That's the first step you can take. The second one is then basically the insights that you get out of that analysis, you need to be able to convert those insights into programs that really drive improvements. So you need to have an execution mechanism in your organization that can use those insights, which are delivering business value, in execution of programs. And then the third part is, and that's one of the most important where the scaling comes in, is that you need to have a mechanism working within your organization between your IT department and your business, where you have basically what I call an industrialization approach, where you can actually, the models that you build, the analytical models, scale to, let's say, solutions that you can then use in your data lake and then basically scale to your enterprise level. And that's when, in the end, if you do that all together and you put a mechanism around that you can actually trace and track the value, you will see that you get the value out of it.
Yeah, and that's a beautiful story, Martin. But can you give an example of a company of or an organization who does this in the right way?
Yeah, of course, I cannot disclose the client name here as it is confidential. But I mean, it's a company in the Netherlands, a listed company. So basically, really big company with 25,000 plus employees. And if you look at an example, and I think this is an example that many of the people listening in today, is that if you look, for example, at do you really understand what is the cost of complexity or what is the cost of non-quality that incurs across your entire value chain, from R&D up to your manufacturing, supply chain, and basically up to when you serve your customers. Now, typically, this is not something that you can, with one press of the button, get out of your ERP system. You need to do something there. You need to build some intelligence on top of all the data tables that are there. And those are, for example, things that we have done at this specific client where we actually connected all those different data tables. We created logic. We built a model. And in this way, we actually industrialize this on their real-time data platforms. And as of today, everybody in the company who has access to the models with one press of the button can see real time for every product across every supplier, every customer in the world, how much non-quality cost did I incur today, yesterday, the day before. It's entirely real time available, and that drives decision making, making also sure that they put the investments at the right place, and that is really have a big impact on their business.
Okay, next, Marije, because skills, they are of course important. What new skills does the workforce need to learn, do you think?
Yes, yeah, Tom, valid question. And that's all about, of course, the re- and upskilling discussion we had also previously, and also what Tracy mentioned. And before we dive into what skills and roles are there are new, I want again to emphasize that it's super important to make a skills assessment of your organization and check in on which work can be done by people. We need to keep the people at the center of work, which can be done by performed by humans. So for example, innovation or design. And secondly, determine which tasks can be automated, for example, which are now manual or repetitive or maybe rules based. And what we then see, main skills are important for people to make the difference in this is things like problem solving, of course, analytics, of course, data management, but also other things like an innovation mindset, storytelling, / communicating effectively. And if we then look to roles, we see new roles popping up mainly from the SAFe framework, so the Skills Agile framework, like agile coaches, product owners, chief product owners, CPO, scrum masters, data scientists, business analysts, but also the more fancy ones like robot monitors or automation specialists. But if we referring also to the story of which Maarten just explained as an example from the client, I also want to highlight in this whole upskilling story, I can imagine that that people are wondering ourselves, okay, but how can I make this work and how can I really embed this in the organization? And I have an example of a current client I'm involved in where we set up the so-called analytics capability building, where re-upskilling is an important part of it, but also the package, it's a complete package. So the innovation, communication, community building, senior leadership alignment, because data became part more and more part of this organization. So a department was built, and we needed to create an environment where people feel comfortable and learn, and also that senior leaders learn and know where to find this new type of work and the successes of it. And from new roles with related competences, correlated learning journeys, thousands of iterations, and then created to the needs of the employees. That's, I think, in my opinion, that's really the success. So I strongly believe in those programs where you create an environment where people really want to work in, they value the attention and engagement, but also the state-of-the-art learning programs spot on for their needs. And that also ties in your culture of your organization.
And what are the results when you are doing it in this way?
Yeah, so actually what I mentioned, what we see is on one hand, you can, for example, only upskill people, but if you don't care for them or don't create an environment where they also can, for example, make mistakes, or they can ask questions, or they will be mentored, or they have a buddy where they feel comfortable, then the risk that will fail is high.
Yeah, and do you think it's hard to make a connection between the workforce part, so the people part, and the technology part?
And what do you mean exactly with that question?
No,
which connection
Maybe it's sometimes for people it's hard to make a connection with the technology or to work with the technology. So maybe that are two different parts in a special way.
Yeah. Of course, you can help your workforce to learn how to work with. Let's say if you take the example of the virtual collaboration tools, what we now also all have to work with. How do you maximize and utilize and get the max out of your technology? That's really also provide them a set of different ways of learning. So, for example, what I mentioned, maybe the mentorship or short videos to learn on digital classrooms, just what is needed then for a particular change or new way of learning. Mm-hmm. And that is what I see make success, especially in a digital and virtual world. Mm-hmm. Also make it personal. That's super important for your organizations, that people really feel connected. And also sometimes make it competitive, for example, that you set up, for example, some minor challenges, weekly or monthly challenges, that people feel connected with each other and then directly learn.
Yeah, about this point, I would also ask Edward about his opinion. Very short, because we have to move on to the third question. But Edward, what are your thoughts?
Yeah, interesting point, and I fully agree with what Maria is saying. But I just want to highlight, if you look at the workforce, I see basically three generations currently active, and that is I'm a middle-aged guy, and I'm part of the middle-aged generation. I grew up using the first home computers, etc. But the generation before me, which is still active, is of course less digitized in that way. But the generation after me, that is, I would say, the generation growing up with the tablets and the Nintendo Switches, etc., it's already digital. And what I see is, if they enter together at shop floor, where often we do things on paper, using paperwork, etc., this last generation, perhaps you would call them millennials, they don't know what to do. They are used to being digital, and then suddenly they need to go back to paperwork. So I think there's also a success is how can we mix up those generation to make this this change, to leverage also these young ones in this to embrace this whole change.
Okay. And then question three. When you have questions or thoughts about the things we talk about, please put them in our chat. You will find the chat within the Hopin platform. Okay, question three. That's your question, Marije. What are the success factors for organizations deploying digital manufacturing? Let's take it away.
Yes. Yeah, so I think, first of all, the upskilling and the analytics capability building story I just explained, that's one of the success factors for me. Secondly, then, of course, transformation also comes in. And that's also the thing mentioned by Peter and Tracy on leading by example is important, the digital doing. But I also strongly believe in using data-driven transformations insights to steer your digital manufacturing, in this case, for example, successfully. And what I mean with that is that I use a platform which is called Transformation GPS, and that's literally your Google Maps of your change or your operating model where you are in on a certain stage, and it benchmarks your current stage to other companies on a global level. And that helps really to steer that data, your transformation journey, spot on, instead of kind of doing guesswork or maybe, okay, I saw that as another client, but yeah, not sure, or maybe be in the dark. And that's very much different than, for example, the SurveyMonkey, because this platform checks in on the current state and then advises next best steps to take. So for example, what I have an example in this, that I was sitting at the C-level table and it was told to me, okay, just send out some extra newsletters. And then I could say, but I see your people need something else because they have lack of clear roles and responsibility and they have lack of resources. So if we do not touch upon that one, the whole change will work counterproductive. So hold this, and then in the case of, for example, the digital manufacturing, you really have then the opposite effect. And I think that's really the new way where we are in now, to also do the sometimes fluffy transformation or change management in a data-driven way. And finally, I would like to conclude with that, and that's maybe also not where you think of directly, but really take care of your workforce, because really make sure they are resilient, especially in this times of COVID, that they can adapt quickly and bounce back when needed, so that they are flexible. And what we also see, for example, from research is that before COVID, around 65% of the workers believed their organization is responsible for their well-being. And after 6 months of being in COVID, it was already 80%. And of course, there are more research statistics and research on it. But for me, that really shows me that employees are expecting more from your organization, for your employer today. And if you want to build that resilience within your people, you have to really start with trust. And I mean with that, I mean with that, so really leaders who listen and respond to that and empathize on that, and that's not built overnight. So I think that's super important, that leaders and organizations care for their people now more than ever.
Hmm. Okay. Edward, what are your thoughts about this subject?
So I think it's you need a clear drive for to make a change, eh? And that drive can come from COVID, that can come from the ever increasing targets you need to make as a business around profitability, safety, efficiency, equality. It could also come from from the leadership, huh? That they have a very clear vision. Once you've identified that, it's important that everyone aligns on that, understands it, and joins that vision, and you set a clear ambition. Once that is available, you need to get started. And it's, to me, it's not climbing the Mount Everest. It's taking step by step, small steps. And these need to be successful. And I think Tracy mentioned that you need to tie that up directly to what value is it creating. And in this way, you're convincing your organization and the different sites. You often also need to find the multinationals, multi-sites, and you need to find a friendly site that is willing to adopt this change, to make this first step. But you need to use that to get everyone on board, to get the rest on board, the rest of the organization, the rest of the people, the rest of the sites on board, to make the next steps. And then it's all about creating this skill to make more steps in a shorter period of time. Mm-hmm.
That's also the statement of Maarten. Maarten, you mentioned go beyond the talk. What do you mean by that?
Yeah, so what my favorite statement says. So I always say you can't talk yourself into a digital transformation. You have to act. And what I mean with go beyond the talk is say, well, you can talk about we need to digitize our operations, our manufacturing, but at a certain moment you need to act. And the thing is that especially in large corporate organizations, over the years, we have basically learned to work in quite controlled environments. But a digitization is more of a journey. And a journey, you of course need to plan, but you need to be flexible to adjust your plans along the way. And that requires a more of an innovative approach. And the approach that is driven by, it's not bad to fail, as long as you learn from it, because it allows you to scale faster afterwards. And that mentality is needed, and it needs a bit different behavior. It also has to do with your workforce, that are you able to deal with that kind of maybe more uncertainty, not knowing exactly where you're heading to, just getting directionally, we need to go there, but learn along the way. And once you do that and you make sure that whatever you do is linked towards business objectives, business value, and you make sure that you get that value initially, you earn money basically to invest again for the next round. And as you earn more and more and create more value, the wheel of value, as I say, will keep spinning, and then that fuels your transformation in the end. And along the way, as long as you see it as a journey and accept it as a journey, that's an important part of becoming this successful in digitization, to my opinion.
We have one more final question, and that's a really important one, because that's the question, what will the manufacturing landscape look like in the future? I would like to start with you, Marije.
Yeah, a good question, Tom. And actually, all what we have said, or what actually I have said, I have to speak for myself, is we are already looking into the future. So more and more the human and AI principle will be at stake. Digital and data savvy cultures will be super important for your organization to focus on, have a clear strategy, make use of technology to, for example, with workplace analytics to predict burnout for well-being, on know what the scaling strategy is needed in terms of which skills do we lack or where do we need to proceed, have your data-driven transformation insights, and then have a layer of that personal empathy and trust, because a lot of our tasks will be automated, so there will be hopefully more room also to focus on each other. I have one thing that I found very interesting is that, and that's actually from the military, you are very strong as groups. When people know each other and like each other, or at least try to like each other, yeah. And support each other.
Okay, thank you. Thanks for that beautiful answer, Edward.
Yeah, indeed, an interesting question. I wish I had this crystal ball to look at how this future looks like. But what we already see happening in some regions of the world, and primarily in this Asia region, Korea, Japan, China, is these fully autonomous factories. Basically, factories without any humans on shop floor. Factories that across the whole product life cycle, the value chain, including manufacturing, are completely autonomous, using robots, using AI, etc. And with a single and even a remote control tower, managing and creating visibility of this factory. And this is, of course, this is highly depending on the, this opportunity on the industry, the type of product, etc. And you see this more in greenfield situations. Well, our challenge is more in the brownfield, the existing factories. But understand that we are up against, potentially against these factories, these autonomous factories.
Yeah.
That we need to compete with them perhaps in several years from now.
Okay, then finally, the thoughts of Martin for the future. Martin.
Yeah, just to augment on that. So I believe, let's say, manufacturing organizations, so the factory of the future, and as you will, it will be a setting where we as humans actually are superpowered by AI algorithms, by cobots, basically to do the work that we do today quicker, faster, better, safer, cheaper. And of course, it depends on the industry, whether you would go to a dark factory, the vision that Edward said, where actually no humans are anymore, or whether there's still a combination of people with some kind of exoskeletons or robots. But in any way, it will be much more digitized. It will be much more, let's say, a combination of humans and automation machines. But in the end, why do we do that? It is to be able to have this quick introduction of products, this mass customization of products. So basically, how I started my story in the beginning, the flexibility to basically deliver upon the demand that we as customers have on the products and services that we want.
Okay, you met the new insiders of this week, Martin, Edward, and Mariah. Thank you very much for joining me. Thank you.